Hello everybody, Alex here. Welcome to my Finance and Accounting Education channel. Today we are going to go full geeks, meaning that we are going to talk about a very technical topic. We are going to talk about group financial statements or consolidation of financial statements for groups of companies. So when you have not only one company but several, which have various relations between them, they are owned in various proportions and so on and so forth. Quite a technical subject, but the focus won't be on the, let's say, how you do the consolidations and, you know, things which you can learn in accounting, but I will focus on something different, building a model that should cover everything that these consolidations imply. But before we jump right in, I'm going to ask you to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button, and you will never miss an update on my side. I do them quite regularly these days. You should expect updates from me on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and also on Sundays. So I'm saying that, starting right with the presentation, so we are going to talk today about these group financial statements, because as I'm always saying, this channel is finance and accounting education channel. And at some point, somebody might ask themselves, okay, where is the accounting in all this? First of all, just like a simple disclaimer, even if I'm not mentioning it specifically, or you think it's not present because I'm not talking about basic accounting stuff, it's still present in almost all my videos. I also have made videos in which I was presenting, so basically teasing about my courses available on Udemy, Patreon, and also LearnFly, links in the description below. And if you are thinking about what kind of courses I have there, I have courses like Finance for Non-Finance, in which I clarify a lot of basic accounting concepts for professionals which are not in accounting. Then there are courses like KPIs, which imply the usage, so using the numbers from financial statements, from P&L, from balance sheet, from cash flow, in order to come up with financial ratios included in several categories. Then you have the entire discussion about the cash flow, probably the best courses or the most interesting and also the most complex courses that I have put out there about the cash flow, because mainly the cash flow is ignored as a financial statement, as a fundamental financial statement in most of the companies. The reason being simple, we focus on the P&L because it shows performance. Cash flow is more about survivability, it's more, some might see it as more operational, and I'm talking about in a separate course about how to build a cash flow for the past results, so like a closing of the period and looking into what happened with your cash relative to the entire performance of the company. But also I have a separate course about the budgeting or forecasting the cash flow, so looking into the future, which poses, let's say, different challenges than building the cash flow for the past. And it's quite simple. If you don't know accounting, then good luck with building a cash flow from my point of view. Also, when I'm talking and I'm presenting a lot of companies, some I'm invested, some are simply interesting, some I don't like at all and I still present them because they are interesting for somebody else, so for the large public. But in there I'm talking about, also I'm presenting their P&Ls, balance sheet, cash flows, and a lot of KPIs and ratios which are derived from this financial statement. So you see, saying that accounting is not present is understating the reality. Then what's up with this group consolidation? So it was, I think, more than 1 year ago when I was studying this marketing management. There is an abstract, so a print screen from one homework that I got. I did it in German language. It happens. I don't know what I was thinking about studying marketing management in German language. I count it to the big mistakes of life. However, you see that it says here that it's a controlling and management topic actually. The idea was that they are talking about the consent model, so this will be a group model for evaluating the strategies in a company. And the idea is that, okay, they start from whatever they want to change, and this model should consolidate all the information that they have about their company, and the, let's say that the latest or the ultimate purpose would be to increase the value of the company. So no decision should be taken without having that in mind, increasing the value of the company. And although it's in German, at some points here, if you just go, you will see that they are talking about Excel, Microsoft Access, so database, Datenbank, that's database, and so on and so forth. The idea is quite simple. I couldn't care less from what kind of database they are using, if they are using Access or some very sophisticated ERP or something else. The idea is that in the end it will have to spill out in a format which fits the IFRS standards, the financial statements of the company, and then you can work with them. So the fact that they are using Microsoft Access is their choice, it's not fundamental. But from all these models, let's say that I didn't pick up everything, so it's not that much about, because they say strategy, I presume that maybe they don't go at the level of business case. Strategy means also long term, so probably several years. So I don't have anything in this model of mine that precedes the financial statements of the individual companies in the group. And also I didn't went that farther in order to see, after you have the financial statements, how you go into all this whole discussion about the price to earnings ratio and the value of the company and so on and so forth. So things which will be of relevance for investors, for example, for the shareholders. And yeah, the idea was to build a, so in the end, what was the idea was to build a model, so in Excel, because it's quite a flexible tool and easy to understand for anybody, to build a model which can cover any situation. So whether you have three companies or 30 and things like this, this model will help you consolidate the financial statements of the companies in that group. The story is quite simple. Usually if you have some professional which is doing that in a company, it will be somebody who's quite senior and quite experienced, they will build something which can be used for that specific company. Maybe if something changes in the group structure, they will update it according to those changes. But it's very hard to find, or because of also lack of time, such an initiative of building a model that could work for any group of companies potentially, or something in this direction. But the idea was to have these automated consolidations, allowing for different types of groups. So just as I have said, between three companies, 30, 50, 60, whatever, all forms of ownership. So you'd have subsidiaries, so more than 50% ownership, joint ventures, so 50-50%. For joint venture, there is also very interesting discussion because you have two methods there. Associates, which will be above 20%. So you still have a significant interest in those companies and available for sales financial assets. Taking into consideration all the possible situations and adjustments needed, like in all this intra-group trading and balances which need to be eliminated. All sorts of structures like D-shaped groups, where you have a parent company that has a stake in another company, but also in a third one, and these companies also have a stake in each other, and you know, this kind of complex situations. Parent of parents group, so you have a company which owns another company, which owns another company, which owns another company, and so on and so forth. Changes in ownership, so dispose or acquisitions, disposals, combinations achieved in stages, so moving from subsidiary to associate and from associate to subsidiary and vice, so all sorts of possibilities. The idea would have to for this model to be quite flexible in terms of the format of balance sheet and P&L. Okay, the guidelines from IFRS are quite clear, but still you might have there some more details, some less details. It depends. There might be more types or classes of assets or liabilities. There might be more lines in your statement of, okay, we call it P&L, but more correctly, statement of comprehensive income. And I think also what's also important is that they should respect all these guidelines from IAS 27 subsidiaries, IAS 28 associates, IAS 31 joint ventures, IFRS 3 goodwill, and everything that's applicable also for available for sales financial assets should be reflected in this model. The way that I did it is that I started with a simple example, and the next example, and the next example, and so basically I fed various scenarios, which are like exercises, in order to cover as much as possible the situations which can happen in reality. The idea was to also test it for structure changes, for example, this simple, like in which order I'm entering the companies in columns and things like this. And the more the model got improved in time, I was also doing some backtracking, meaning that I was re-inputting the previous scenarios to see if they still hold, if the model still works for them, even if it got somehow enhanced, it gained in complexity. I'm not saying necessarily improved, because everything is an improvement at this stage. And yeah, the idea was to see if it maintains the structure integrity. Although I think that there is much to be done, I'm saying here at last, it's still not very visually friendly. I didn't look at all it at this part of having the model, let's say, formatted and looking nice and colorful or not that colorful, and you know, grid lines and things like this, how the tables are formatted, the numbers and so on and so forth. I still think that some of the, I mean, they work, the functionalities are working, but they are unfriendly for end users. For example, I will show you immediately these intragroup transactions which need to be eliminated are entered in a matrix form where you have let's say horizontally, vertically you have the suppliers and horizontally you have the customer companies in the group. The problem is that once you input more companies, you have to somehow expand those matrices both to the right of your Excel but also to the bottom, so it's quite complex. And the idea is that for now, I'm not sure if the model is covering enough or a reasonable large number of real-life situations. I'm quite sure it will cannot cover all of them, but the idea is that, let's say, if I'm not covering 5% of the real-life situations, what can happen in the transactions and so on and so forth, it's okay if it doesn't cover 40% or 60%, or it's as good as not at all. Jumping a little bit, so just trying to show you a little bit of the things which are inside the model. So just as I have said, you have a lot of comments here, so, and I'm not sure that I have documented everything what the people should take care. So the model has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sheets. The idea is that you have a lot of premises which are not captured in the balance sheet. So you have the balance sheet structures, then you have the profit and loss structure, but additionally to this input data you have these premises. Basically this is information that is not included in the balance sheet or in the profit and loss or in the statement of financial position or in the statement of comprehensive income, but somehow you still need to take them into consideration when you are consolidating. Then you have the working, so all the adjustments which are required, with red here, for example, there are things that are not yet tested, or I don't like the solution, the Excel solution that I found for them, and yeah, And in the end, the idea is to come up with a consolidated statement of financial position and with a consolidated statement of comprehensive income. Just as I have said, okay, what's it now with the yellow marked? It means simply that you can or you should input data in here. Otherwise, everything else should be calculated. You see these matrices like for intra-group sales, like intra-group sales profit margin, share of sales before year-end, unrealized profit goods not paid, and so on and so forth. And they are in this matrix. The way that the model works is quite simple. Once you know that you have columns till XFD, all the formulas are starting with, let's say, with B, and they go to XFD, and hence you can enter as many companies as possible, not unlimited, but till XFD you have a quite a large number of companies which you can input. And the idea is that also here in this case you should also input lines, not only columns. Lines also you have a lot of space in the balance sheet, especially if you have some other. Here it's like quite compact, not that many elements of the balance sheet, or not that many elements of the statement of financial position, or not that many elements of statement of comprehensive income. You just need to input them to give them a coding and to be sure that you also have them in the included somehow in the consolidated statements. However, I was just thinking that this matrix system doesn't really work because it's complex, and even when I'm teaching Excel or when somebody is telling me that they want a pivot table, I'm telling them that if they want a pivot table, they should give me a list. And it seems that okay, it's always good to do what the preacher is telling you to do and not what the preacher does. So it seems that I fell in the same trap because this kind of matrix has this type of structure like a pivot table, and I should probably use a list. And you do just a column on which you say seller, one on which you say supplier, and with a drop down list. Remember the drop down list you get from data validation, and you say, I want a list. And it should be this list, and we are making sure it's going to XFD. We said it's the last one. And the idea is that you can say that piece is selling to, and you do the same with the with the supplier. Piece is selling to meal prep. In this case, is a prep disposal company, and you say it's selling 100, and you know, and then you have the next transaction. And because in real life you can have a lot of transactions, here somehow they should be summarized. Here with such a list is easier, and you no longer need to summarize it, and you can just enter as many as possible you need. And yeah, I think this would work far better than this matrix approach, but that remains to be improved. Yeah, and a lot of very interesting things here in the calculations and what you should actually input. Also, there are, just as I have said, for example, for the treatment of joint ventures, you have two methods, equity method and 50% consolidation, and you need to state this. Where do you, for example, the impairment losses in which P&L element you recognize them, and so on and so forth. Then for the non-controlling interest, you always have, according to IFRS 3, I think I said to goodwill, you have two methods, proportionate and fair value, and it should the model, so the workings, the adjustments should work according to what you are selecting here. And also in the workings, for example, if you are this, you have a disposal in the group. For example, this should calculate nothing if you retain the control. Then you have an adjustments of parents' equity on disposal with control retained. This should also calculate nothing, when you lose the control, then you have an associate direct the recognition. So just as I have said, you can go from subsidiary to to joint venture as well, but to associate, from associate to available for sale financial assets, and then you will have to de-recognize the associate and all the other calculations, which for example you will need to have the computation for, or the working from the for the goodwill. In case you have an investment in associate or in joint venture, then the group reserves, which will be made from the group of from the reserves of the parent, and proportionate or not, it depends what kind of consolidation you have for the other companies. Okay, non-controlling interest in balance sheet, non-controlling interest in profit and loss, a lot of fair value adjustments, intra-group trading, also removing the these intra-group balances, like if one company owes to the other one something, for the outside world, to the group, that's absolutely not relevant. Actually, it's increasing the assets and the liabilities of the group. I think it can be also for creative accounting, can be a technique to manipulate some KPIs, if you ask me, because if you can do these transactions between the companies within the group, you can, and you don't need to eliminate these balances, you can manipulate the KPIs, like we know the liquidity and gearing and so on and so forth. Then share of associate or joint venture in the profit for the year, or the in total comprehensive income, provision for unrealized profit on joint venture holding inventory unsold, impairment losses, and so on and so forth. So you see a lot of adjustments, and somehow it's just as I have said, it doesn't look very good. I just marked with yellow the things which I need to input right now, and there was a lot of backtracking and back and forth, and what happens if I put the post company on column D and on column C actually, and the pre company on column D, and so on and so forth, and there are still a lot of things to be, let's say, improved. But I think I'm on the good track, and what is important from my point of view is that A, it will be helpful also for students if they get such a model, because if they understand this model, that means that they understand also consolidations. Maybe it's easier to understand consolidations if you understand the formulas behind. Some of the formulas here are quite wild. I didn't really show you, but if you go, you might find formulas on two, three lines in the formula bar and things like this. And if I think that if the students which are learning about group financial statements and consolidations have such a model, maybe they will understand easier what's going on, because they will have the multiple situations together, so not really going through all the models, and they will say, okay, if I have this, it happens like this, if I have that, it happens like that. Also, I think that it's also very useful for myself, keeping up to date with the concepts, but I also think that this such a model that is can be used for any group of companies also has some value, meaning that I could probably sell such a model as a product, as a consolidation tool, because for the reason that I have told you, I think that the companies always find some quick and dirty solution that cannot be applied to all of them, and such a model might be very, very valuable. That was it for today about the group consolidations. So that we didn't went that much into technical clarifications and things like this. You can find in all over the internet, in the accounting books, in IFRS, in all the examples possible, and you can find there more theoretical details. I'm more interested about building this model. And I hope you enjoyed the presentation of today. I don't know. I'm also testing right now to see if there are many people interested in purely accounting topics here on YouTube. Once again, my name is Alex Petrescu. Thank you for your attention. If you like the video, please don't forget to hit the like button, to share it with somebody that might be interested about the topic. to comment if you have something to add to the conversation, but most importantly to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button, and you will never miss an update on my side. I do them quite regularly these days, on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays. You should expect new and hopefully interesting videos on my side. Also below this video we have links. Through the first link you can create an eToro account and trade there without a commission or a fee, which is always a saving no matter how often you are doing it. But also there is a wish list with hardware and software items that can help me improve the quality of my videos, thus being beneficial also for you, because you'll get of course better videos on my side. However, from financial perspective, the wish list is the least inconvenient, so the most inconvenient for you. The easiest way through which you can support me is to hit to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button, and of course to continue to watch my videos. Thank you for your time and patience today here on my Finance and Accounting Education channel. Once again, my name is Alex Petrescu and I look forward to presenting to you with next opportunity. Goodbye!